Thank you. 529, draw the light of your love. told by me. Jesus is always in the ministry of teaching. He's at the right hand of his Father, but he's still teaching us to the world. About a week after he was speaking about his impending suffering and death, he took with him Peter, James, and John on the top of a mountain to pray. Suddenly his face changes. His clothes become dazzling white. Oh, what an experience. Moreover, Moses and Elijah were seen talking with him, and Peter could neither contain nor control himself. He said to Jesus, how good it is for them to be there. He then suggested to Jesus, making two dwellings, one for Jesus, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed him. The end of verse 24 says, they were terrified, and they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, this is my son, my chosen, listen to him. Isn't it interesting that a voice came from the cloud? The cloud is not below, but above. It was no mean voice. It was an elevated voice. A voice, if heeded, would lift. What sort of voice are we listening to? What sort of voices do we listen to? Do we listen to the voices that lift, or those that would debase us? We should always pray, glory be God, and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. For my life and grace, when I am from, glory be from my soul. Certainly, it was not a voice that lifted. It was a voice that lifted when pointed to the Messiah of Jesus. No mean personality, God's chosen son. Now Peter, James, and John, I want you to know that he was listening to me. He's my chosen. Are we going to listen to Jesus, who was chosen? And to dramatize the situation so that it can sink in. When the cloud was lifted, Jesus was long alone. It is only Jesus alone we should listen to. A few days ago, in our reading, Jesus warned us about the Antichrist. Remember that? That there are those who will come in his name. Anyone who comes preaching another message should not be entertained. In Mark chapter 8, Jesus spoke past to Peter when Peter rebuked him for trying to explain his messiahship. To explain that his messiahship would entail his death and resurrection. Remember that? That was a great mountaintop experience. It was supposed to give the disciples a glimpse of what it would be like in God's kingdom. It was on the mountaintop, on the mountains of Ararat, that Moses asked came to rest after the flood. You see that in Genesis 8:4. One made a covenant with the Lord. On Mount Sinai, also known as Mount Moriah, God revealed his character to Moses and gave him the Ten Commandments. And we see that in Exodus 19:16-20. Jesus taught his disciples in the Mount of Olives, Matthew 24:3, and he was transfigured on the mountain, and Shiva 19. It shouldn't surprise us that most of you have done, both have their own mountains of experience for talking to Jesus on that mountain. So mountains are symbolic of God's revelation to man. God gives the mountains of experience in order to sustain his people as they go down into the valley. His revelation is always intended to help us journey with him more closely on the road ahead. Many of us have had our own earthly mountain top experiences. Those times when we felt like we were on top of the world, really happy, confident that we know, that we knew all the answers and could solve any problem that came up. The moment might have come at some exciting event in your life, graduation, your first year, or your first job, or wedding, or the birth of a child. Or it might have been spiritual when you felt that we were really close to God, really in tune with God's plan for us. Maybe a week at a church retreat. For me, it was like the spirit experience. Another occasion of my journey to my ordination in that, and the day of wedding to that special lady you see sitting here. In those moments, we with excitement and alive. Everything seemed new. And how we hate to come down off that mountain. We want to hang on to that moment. But as long as we can, let us stay right here and let the rest of the world go for a while. But to bring that one moment in time, such of the possibility of the next moment. Mountaintop experiences are a gift of grace. They are also the catalyst of transformation. Luke says that Jesus was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his garment became as white as the grass. Everyone who had a genuine mountaintop experience is transformed in the process. When you're being to the normal God, never so seem to be quite the same again. Mountaintop experiences never get to lead to the valley below. The valley below. Look at what follows on the heels of Jesus' transfiguration. He and Peter and James and John come down from the mountaintop only to meet a man with a son who has epilepsy, begging for Jesus to heal him. So much for the ecstasy. There's work to be done, and not a moment to spare. After you have that experience, there's work to be done. All in all, mountaintop experiences are important. They're a gift. As I've said before, great God, grace and love. They're a catalyst of transformation. We're not meant to last forever, or they inevitably lead to the valley. That's what gets us through the toil and grind. says, and his might coming in closing the deal of a lifetime. For an attorney, lawyer, in winning the big case, what teacher is seen as student being successful in an examination. Mounting from experiences, as I said, and the means of transformation. Matthew also said that Jesus was transfigured before. Those who are part of genuine mounting from experience are transformed in the process. In the Bible, mountains are often placed together for what they encompass people, changing their lives and send them back down to the world with a message for his people. Noah's back settled on a mountain top when the flood waters receded, and after Noah offered God a sacrifice there, he later made a new covenant with creation, promising never to bring such destruction again to the world again. Mountain top experience that moments where people experience a dramatic expression of faith. Perhaps they were previously going down the wrong path, or filled with anger, or suffering from depression, addiction, or some state of confusion. But then, out of nowhere, God's presence came near to them. The eyes opened and we saw a whole new reality. And one lady confided, she was a typical party girl with very little concern about her spiritual life. Then one day, at the carnival party, suddenly popped into her head. What are you doing here? She was drunk. She did not accept it. The woman said, what are you doing here? She left the party and let go of their God to pass through that journey. Needless to say, he saved her life, and she started paying attention to her spiritual life. The kindness of circumstances, the moment of experience, is for men the moment that God will meet in such a way. And they too, even at the thought of him. Unfortunately, the moment of the Lord lasts forever. Wherever there are mountains, there will be valleys. When you are there, trouble will be righteous. But the world will go there. But the world. Eventually, man is supposed to come to be mad. So no doubt the sister has to look for ways to stay on the mountain. You may decide to recommit yourself to Christ and the Christian way, possibly by weekly church attendance. You may even start looking at your life choices and reevaluate the way you have been living. Perhaps you search for good Christian books to read on discipleship and read and study the Bible daily. Or maybe some of the things you know. Visit the ship. When I was in prison, you visited me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When you've been to the mountaintop, you never see things in the quite the same way again. The Christian mountaintop experience is come in contact with the Word of God. And the Word of God is conviction, conviction. You need to have a personal experience with Jesus. You need to be changed from the inside out. Then by knowing Jesus' true identity, you can overcome all of life's troubles and fears. Experiencing God regularly requires discipleship. Jesus called the disciples to come and follow him. You must be close to God in order to continue to experience his presence. Spending time with God is the only way to do this. Spending time with God and learning from that time in the heart of discipleship. Forgiveness and patience are also required. Learning to experience God's presence doesn't happen overnight. It takes a lot of time and perseverance. Discipleship also requires understanding that God is walking with you every moment of the day. Awareness of this will help you see a whole new dimension. You leave here transformed into a new person, functioning as God will have you do. There's something I want you to consider. And I credit my decision on the promise in sight. Peter was given Moses and Elijah parity with Jesus. Peter was given Moses and Elijah parity with Jesus. And any time, God bless your soul. Anytime you place anyone on the same level with Jesus, you are under a cloud. You are not seeing clearly. Who put him on the same thing with Muhammad or Buddha? Brothers and sisters, let's remove the cloud and listen to the voice of God. Surrender to Jesus, and Jesus alone. Russia's cooking to know that. And I now invite you to turn with me to hymn 494. Mr. Taylor. For 494.
Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in his bed. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In our prayers of intercession today, we pray the wider Anglican Communion for the Most Reverend Honourable Justin Welby, Archbishop of Canterbury. We pray also for the Anglican Church of Kenya and its Primate and Archbishop, the Most Reverend Jackson Ole Sapit. In our own province of the West Indies, we pray for our Archbishop, the Most Reverend Howard Brethren, Primate and Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
In our own diocese, we pray for our Bishop of Paul, after the case of the role of caring for the living life. Lord, continue to guide us by your team and give the assurance that you are with us to your Holy Spirit. We pray for all sisters and sisters of God, Lord, and God, for the clergy and all of the world. We pray that all of those who are truly Christians and true to God, sacraments that we administer and pray to receive by the Spirit, possible life, and following the example of your Son. And we show the power of God for all of our movies to be the Christ of the Lord. Amen. Lord, we worship
you. Amen. We
pray today in our diocese and sacrament of prayer for the parish of St. Christopher to Korea, for the parish of the Reverend Father Aaron Charles, and the Lord who found. Lord, for mercy, we pray for people calling me and all the rest of the mission and vision of the church. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the nation and state of the United Kingdom, the experts, the president, the parliament, the honorable prime minister, the leaders of the world, the chairman of the Labour Association, the Kabbalah Gospel, all members of the THK, all members of the Parliament, the Chief Justice, Mr. Larry Ash, all members of the Ministry, the people of our nation. Lord, bless the leaders of our lands. We give the people of peace in all ourselves, and bless him of all the nations, the opposition of the world. Lord, in your name.
Amen.
We pray for peace. We give them the same gift from the tent. Pray for the grave. Stay there for the man who just. Hurry and run to go attack from you while you're waiting. It's an act of waiting. This is our trust in Jesus Christ, the Lord of peace. We pray for an urgent ceasefire and the withdrawal of Russian forces. We call for a common decision to prune the way for peace and the international.
Yeah,
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore confess our sins.
Thank you. I just want to ask you to start this video.
And today we thank you for the kindness of the servants you give for the work of your church and our mission in the world. Make us mindful of those who without them cannot give, so that we can be a blessing to them and we seek to be your way. Accept the gifts of your people and teach us how to use them for the sake of the kingdom. This we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. And your Savior taught us.
Of God, for the people of God. Our soul is satisfied, and we will sing glad songs of praise to Him.
393.
Thank you.
participants in Lenten caravan activities. And for
the Lenten paradigm is, so in South region, when we
Mission services, we got the stations of the cross.
also have a message from the hospitality committee. From Mr. Charlie Matthews on behalf of the herself and other members of the hospitality committee from the hospitality group. The hospitality group will be participating in a virtual lantern retreat next Sunday afternoon, March 6th. The group will also be holding the annual Palm Sunday breakfast on April 10th. Tickets at a cost of $40 will be soon available from any member of the group. Proceeds will be used to fund the following. An Easter event, which is Food and Toiletries Drive, a collaborative effort by the Hospitality Group, the Youth Ministry, and Mr. Anthony Carver Graves. Hampers will be delivered at Easter to members of our church in need of support, as well as members of the wider community. Congregation members will also be encouraged to donate towards this cause. On behalf of the clergy and parishioners, we would like to say immense, to convey our immense gratitude to the persons who came out yesterday to take part in the cleanup project exercise. And these are, we would like to say a special thank you to Julian and Peterman Warren, Paul Williams, Denise Francois, Phil Scare, Mr. McConnell, Mrs. Sylvester, Mr. Waddell Estelle, Mrs. Geraldine Matthews, Mrs. Joan Lacker-Zabe, Mr. Jenna Cave, Mrs. Brenda Bach, Mrs. Janine Wallace-Scare, and Miss Mary Hill. And we want to thank for providing meals to those persons who came out to clean yesterday, Mrs. Roberts and Ethan Roberts, and Ms. Elvira Boyce. Thank you as well to those who made contributions to the cleanup project, Mrs. Zyde Paris and Mr. Rhodes, and all those who contributed, all others who contributed in cash or kind. Any names on the board will be left out. We say thank you for your support. Also, we have pleasant news with regard to our young ones from today's Newsday Kids. Today, Sunday, February 27th, on the cover, we have Mrs. Sylvester's granddaughter.
The second thing I want
invite you to tune in to the Lenten training program. The Lenten training program will be launched next week in the churches, and Father Dr. Perry Thompson said that he will shorten his sermon so that you can see the first edition, series number one, of what the Lenten training program is going to be. Now, I want to plead with you to log in. When we did the Advent program, we did have enough people on board. And so we are pleading with you now to come in. The Lenten aspect is the deepest aspect of our Christian faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. So as we go through that program, we want to acknowledge that and build our spirituality. I want to thank all the people who have come on board. The choir and the music ministry in totality, they have been looking amidst all forms of difficulties to be here and be part of the program. Let's give them a round of applause. I want to thank Mr. Carl Williams and not see Mrs. Kieran, Corbett Branson, or Ms. Keisha Free, but they are going to be facilitators on the program. And at this point in time, I want to raise up both the music ministry and all the presenters. And I wanted to say anointed call on them, because we really want the Holy Ghost Spirit to move them so that we can be a blessing to everyone in the parish and to them. Amen. So let us just picture all these three people in our spiritual mind, and let's say anointed call on them. Thank you.
Thank you.